I want to show you two proofs of Euclid's lemma, one that uses the fundamental theorem of arithmetic, and a second that uses the fact that the GCD of two natural numbers is a linear combination of those numbers. Euclid's lemma states that if p is a prime number and p divides the product a times b, then p either divides a or p divides b, or it could divide both. Before we look at either of these proofs, let's take a moment to notice the assumption that p is prime is a necessary assumption. For example, if p is 6, 6 does happen to divide 3 times 4, which is 12. 12 divided by 6 is 2, but 6 does not divide either factor. It does not divide 3, and 6 does not divide 4. So this conclusion would fail if p were 6. P is a prime is necessary. All right, let's look at proof one. It's going to be based on the fundamental theorem of arithmetic, which says that each natural number greater than or equal to 2 has unique prime factorization. And we're going to also prove this by something called the contrapositive. We're going to assume the opposite of the conclusion and show the opposite of the assumption. The hypothesis is what follows from that, under the overall assumption still that p is prime. We're going to assume p does not divide a and p does not divide b and show p does not divide a times b. So start with the fundamental theorem of arithmetic. I'll just abbreviate that FTA. The fundamental theorem of arithmetic implies that both a and b have unique prime factorizations. Say a is q1 to the m1 power, where q1 is prime and m1 is some positive power, times q to the m2 power, etc. There's going to be some number of unique prime factors here. Let's say there are alpha of them, just to pick a different letter. The last prime factor is going to be q sub alpha to the m sub alpha power. And b is going to be written in some similar kind of way. Say R1 to the N1 times R2 to the N2, etc., down to R sub beta to the N sub beta. Now, this is fancy looking notation, but the idea is basic. These Q's and these R's are, in each case, for both things individually, unique primes, and these M's and N's are positive powers. Could some of the Q's equal some of the R's? Yes, they could. A and B could have some prime factors in common. Now assume, as I said before with the contrapositive here, that p does not divide a and, not or, but and, p does not divide b. Assume p does not divide a and p does not divide b. Since p does not divide either a or b, p can't possibly be one of these prime factors in either case. P cannot be one of the q's and p cannot be one of the r's. This implies p does not equal qi for any of the I subscripts from 1 to alpha, and P does not equal any of the RIs. I'll call them RJs just to use a different letter. Does not equal RJ for any J goes from 1 to beta. That's what follows if we assume P does not divide A and P does not divide B. Again, the goal is to show P does not divide A times B. Well, A times B is the product of all these things. Now again, some of the Q's could equal some of the R's, but we don't have to really rewrite this in any other kind of fancy way based on that assumption. We can just say this is the prime factorization of A times B based on these prime factors of A and B, and yes, again, you could combine these. I'll just mention that. And again, with the fundamental theorem of arithmetic, we know this prime factorization is unique. We have unique primes from this. P was not one of the Q's, P was not one of the R's, P is not any of these primes. Therefore, P does not divide A times B. Again, we're using the fundamental theorem of arithmetic and the fact that in this case, prime factorizations are unique. Now let's move on to proof two. Proof two, you might say, is a bit fancier. It uses something called the GCD is a linear combination theorem, the fact that the greatest common divisor of two natural numbers is a linear combination of them. We're going to be doing what's really a direct proof in this case, but it is a direct proof with a little bit of a twist, you might say. The fact that the conclusion is, you know, in the form of an OR statement means it's a little funny. We're going to go ahead and assume P is prime and that P does divide A times B. And without loss of generality, we're going to assume the opposite of this one, that P does not divide A, and we'll show that it follows that P divides B. You might ask, what happens if we assume P does not divide B? We'd have to show P divides A, but that would be a very similar argument. So it's good enough to just do one of them. Okay, so we go ahead and go down here and we say, assume, again, we have the background assumption that P is prime, that P does divide A times B, but P does not divide A. We must show that P does divide B. Okay? The fact that P does not divide A and the fact that P is prime, P does not divide A and P is prime, implies, in fact, that A and P are relatively prime or coprime. A and P are relatively prime. Sometimes people call that coprime. In other words, i.e., the GCD of A and P equals 1. Now we apply this GCD is a linear combination theorem. GCD, linear combo theorem, implies that we can find there exists integers S and T, one of which will be a negative number, but that's not a big deal, such that, ST means such that A times S plus P times T equals that GCD 1. What's our goal again? Our goal is to show P divides B. P does divide P times T. P doesn't divide 1, for sure. Does P divide that? Well, if we multiply it by B, it would, because we're assuming P divides A times B. Yeah, that's the step that you do next. Multiply everything by B. You'll get ABS plus PBT equals B. We want to show P divides B. Again, P definitely divides P times B times T because there's a P there. And P does divide this because we're assuming it divides A times B. P divides ABS. P divides PBT. It would take a little extra proof if you wanted to do so as a lemma. If P divides two numbers, it will also divide their sum. I'll let you prove that on your own. This implies P divides the sum, P divides B, and we're done. Thanks for watching.